My name is Sue Lang, and I'm a volunteer docent here at the Williamson Lincoln Smith Gallery. I want to give you a little bit of history about the gallery. People wonder why these wonderful paintings are out here in Shasta. Well, years ago, in the 1870s, a young girl, only 8 years old, moved to Shasta from Missouri, and her name was May Helene Bacon Boggs, and she had an uncle named Williamson Lincoln Smith. And since she lost her dad even before she was born, Williamson became essentially her surrogate father. And he took her under his wing, and they had a wonderful relationship. And that is the reason she wanted to name this gallery after him. What's so much fun about this gallery in the research that I've been doing is the relationships between the among the artists, and what I also understand the relationship that May Helene Bacon Boggs had with many of these people. In her adult life, she married late in life. I think she was around 38 or so, and she married and she moved to San Francisco, lived on Nob Hill with her husband, Mr. Boggs, and it was there that she started collecting paintings. She loved art. She loved all kinds of artifacts. What's represented here in these two galleries represents a fraction of the things that she had collected over her life. She lived in San Francisco, as many of these artists did. San Francisco back in the day was quite an artistic community. It was sort of the Paris of the West. So it's no surprise that these artists were gravitated towards San Francisco. And the other thing that's very interesting, and I'll point it out as we look at various painters' work, who their relationships that they had with each other, who taught who shared galleries in San Francisco together. So that's an interesting aspect too, when you get that connectivity. Another area of connectivity has to do with the Bohemian Club in San Francisco. The Bohemian Club was started by a writer, Bret Hart, a friend, some would say, of Mark Twain. Others say they became not friends at the end of their lives, but Bret Hart started the Bohemian Club, and the reason he did that was San Francisco and California at the time was pretty rough and ready place. All these people coming to claim their fortune in the gold country, and they were a pretty rough group. So Bret Hart, being a writer, wanted to start a group, an organization that was composed of writers and painters, and that was the Bohemian Club. And they weren't wealthy, but they were the original meaning of the word bohemian. I'm starting in the second room of the gallery. There's so many interesting stories to tell you in here. May Helene Bacon Boggs was so active in San Francisco. She was part of the 1915 Pan-Pacific Exposition. When you look around and you will see many of the artifacts that she collected during that time. And it also coincides with some of these painters, because many of these painters had gallery exhibits at the Pan-Pacific Exhibition. It's my understanding that during that time, of course, we were looking at World War I in Europe, and many of the artwork had to stay in Europe. It was difficult to get it to California for the exhibit, so they utilized California artists, which was a great springboard for so many of these artists. The first one I want to talk about is William Keith up here in the corner. William Keith died right before the 1950 Pan-Pacific Exposition. And so in tribute to him, he was so revered, in tribute to him, they did a whole exhibit of his work in honor of him. What's interesting about William Keith, and I love this story, William Keith was born in Scotland, I believe it was 1838, at the same year that John Muir was born, and they both lived in Scotland. They did not know each other when they lived in Scotland. William Keith moved to San Francisco. He studied watercolor for a time with a woman that he ultimately married. That marriage did not last that long because of her premature death. He then married another woman who was the first graduate of Hastings Law School, and she was a suffragette. So whether May Helene Bacon Boggs knew her, my guess is she probably did, because as we know, May Helene Bacon Boggs was also a suffragette. But getting back to William Keith, he and his relationship with John Muir, they did not know each other, even though they were exactly the same age, born the same year, until he came to, till William Keith came to San Francisco, and he wanted to paint the wonderful landscapes in Yosemite. And he knew that John Muir knew an awful lot about navigating the hills and wilds of Yosemite. So he hooked up with John Muir, and John Muir took him to the Yosemite Valley. And that launched a lifelong relationship with each other and a lifelong friendship. And they had sort of a good-natured joshing and jibing that they would do back and forth to each other, and one would give as good as they got. So that's what I've read, and I can quite imagine these two Scottish men going at each other, but all good-naturedly. So as you can see, William Keith, that particular painting up here is sort of rather dark, and that was the tonal school of art at the time. William Keith changed over time, but this is a quote that I remember reading, and I get such a kick out of it. William Keith, as I said, with his friendship with John Muir said to him one time, "Will," he says, "why don't you just paint what you see? How can you improve on nature?" And William Keith said, "John, anybody can paint what they see. I want to paint what I feel." So that's that tonal school. It's not as representational as it is to evoke a certain feeling. It's also interesting to note that William Keith studied under Samuel Brooks. And we have a painting up here over in this section done by Deakins. And Deakins shared a studio in San Francisco with Marston Brooks. And that is such a wonderful picture. If you take time to look deeply into it, and you can see that he's a painting of the studio of his cohort. And it was William Keith studied with him when he first came to San Francisco. You can see that this is, the artist is Thaddeus Welch, and Thaddeus Welch studied with William Keith. So you can see these interrelationships with all of these artists and how each one may have learned a little something from the other. In addition to their formal training, some of them went to Paris, some of them went to Germany to further their artistic education. But what's unique about this is that we have this progression of paintings of Thaddeus Welch. And the very first one is dated in 1872. Now, this is before Thaddeus had any real formal training. He loved to paint. He was pretty much self-taught at this time in his life. And you can see the painting is certainly a respectable painting, but it doesn't have the depth that you will see as we progress with his work. The next painting is in 1877, so 5 years later. Thaddeus moved to San Francisco, of course, and he was trying to learn and perfect his art. And there was this particular patron, a woman of wealth, who was intrigued by his talent, or perhaps maybe she saw his potential. And she took him under her wing and became his benefactor and sent him to school in Germany. So this painting represents the time that he was studying in Germany. And you can see how it differs so much from this one, the darker sort of German style of painting. And then we go over to this painting in 1897. Now we're jumping, we're jumping again. And this is a painting, and for those of you who are from Portland or familiar with Portland, you might recognize this very spot. So this is a view up there is Mount Hood. And he had, his mother lived in Portland, and I think this may have been done when he went up to visit her after he was studying in San Francisco. The next painting, oh, and in between here, during his life, he met a gal by the name of Ladmilla, and she was a German gal, and he met her on the East Coast near where his patron lived and had commissioned him to do various paintings. And she was quite a bit younger than he, but they did marry, and they worked together. She became a student of his, and she learned painting from him. But during this time, they were truly bohemians. They lived in a tent in Marin County, and I don't know whether they were poaching, but I think they were on land that wasn't theirs, and they had no money at all, but they lived on just what they would make with their paintings. Then Thaddeus Welch was able to have an exhibit at the Bohemian Club. Again, that Bohemian Club comes up again. And he, after that exhibit, he was well in demand, and his career had taken off. So we moved. The reason I mentioned Ladmilla is that she was very good at painting farm animals. Now, I don't know this for a fact, but it has been said that perhaps Ladmilla and Thaddeus worked in concert with each other. Perhaps Ladmilla did the farm animals and Thaddeus did the landscapes. When I take people through the gallery, they love this painting the most. At the very end, I always ask people, what's your favorite painting? And invariably, they'll say, it's this one. And this one was done shortly before Thaddeus' death. And this is 1915, again, the year of the Pan-Pacific Exposition. But everyone loves the light in that. It just looks like it's illuminated from within. So I think this is an interesting array of paintings that we can see the progression of an artist and his craft. I'd like to draw your attention to the Stoke Pogus Church, and it's done by Charles Rollo Peters. Now, as you can see, or perhaps you can't, if you look right on straight with this particular painting, you don't see much. It almost looks like an ink, a Rorschach test, but it's not. This type of painting is called a nocturne. It was popular at one time. I think it was begun by Whistler. Matter of fact, Peters revered Whistler. He was a mentor of his. But what you have to do is look at this painting from about this location. And if you get right about here and the light shines on it just right, you can see the stained glass windows and the illumination from within in the church. But if you look at it straight on, you won't be able to appreciate that. The backstory on Peters, he was also called the Prince of Darkness, which you certainly can understand from this painting. So in the 1915 exposition in San Francisco, essentially it was a big, among other things, it was a big PR event to show the world that San Francisco was up and running and the lights were on and San Francisco was ready for business again. So Mr. Peters wanted to do an exhibit at the Pan-Pacific Exposition. And he was denied that opportunity by the promoters. And the only thing I can think of is that if you wanted to prove to the world that the lights were on, your vivid, vibrant city again, I'm not quite sure you'd want that style of painting. That's my personal opinion. He was miffed by the fact that he was turned down because he was considered quite an accomplished painter. And so he went off and he had his own exhibit separate from there, but at the separate from the exhibit in San Francisco, but nearby. One of my favorite painters is featured up here. We have three paintings of his, and that's Maynard Dixon, full name Lafayette Maynard Dixon. And we have ones that were done early in his career in the 1920s. When he was a child, he was rather sickly, as we understand Ansel Adams was, and many artists who perhaps were confined to their home, and they developed other academic interests and artistic interests. Well, this was true with Maynard Dixon, and he loved to paint, he loved to draw, and so he wrote a letter one time to Remington. Everyone's familiar with Remington and his wonderful Western sculptures. And he wrote a letter to him maybe it was about 12 or something. And he asked him for advice. And Remington said to him, back to Maynard Dixon, oh, and Maynard sent a few of his sketches to him too. And Remington said, you've got promise. But he says, this would be my advice to you every single day. Draw, 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 draw. And he took that advice throughout his life. There was never a day that he didn't do drawing. He was involved with Sunset Magazine, the very first editions of Sunset Magazine. And if you see some of the early covers of Sunset Magazine, Maynard Dixon will be represented there. He was commissioned to go to the West and the Midwest after the railroad was put in by Harper's Magazine, and they were trying to encourage people to come west on the train. And so he was sent out west to draw pictures and send them back to put in the magazines to entice people to travel west. And so this was the time period when he was in the Midwest doing these paintings. What's interesting about this is that he was married and lived in New York for a time and had a daughter, and her name was Constance. And he moved to California, and Constance stayed in New York. And during the summer, Constance could come and visit her dad. So this particular painting up here is a painting of Constance's pony, and that's Maynard Dixon's daughter, and she was visiting that summer. And there's a reference that I read about how Constance said that was the happiest summer of her life, was the life that she spent with her dad. So the summer she spent with her dad. One other thing I'd like to tell you about Maynard Dixon before we leave this corner of the gallery. As I said, these paintings were done early in his career. Just like Thaddeus Welch, painters change over time and develop their voice. And Maynard Dixon was no different. He ultimately became known as the painter of the West, and he went to the Southwest and painted more sort of isolated kinds of scenery. And if you've ever seen some of those paintings from that time frame, there's nobody that does clouds like Maynard Dixon. A little bit of that you can see here, but in his later works, they're absolutely beautiful. Because I talked about his first wife and how that ended in divorce, and then he met a photojournalist by the name of Dorothea Lange, who's probably the most noted for her picture of the migrant woman that was taken in the 1930s. She traveled through the migrant camps to chronicle the situation there for the federal government. So Maynard Dixon and Dorothea Lange had two sons, and Maynard Dixon moved to to the South, or spent a lot of time in the Southwest painting, and that wasn't particularly good for their marriage, and so their marriage also ended in divorce. The interesting thing about Maynard Dixon and Dorothea Lange is that Dorothea Lange had a photography studio in San Francisco, right near Maynard Dixon's studio. And so they were living in San Francisco during the Depression in the 1930s, and Maynard Dixon would go outside in the streets of San Francisco and see these despondent people who couldn't find work, and it was a very sad place to be. And you will see a few of his paintings, if you research it, about that time. And he said, I don't want to do this anymore. And that's when he picked up and went to the Southwest to draw and paint those wonderful Western scenes. All right. I'd like to talk about Otis Oatfield today. And he has three of his paintings are up here in the first gallery room. The first one over here is called One Can Dairy on the Narrow Gauge. Otis Oatfield's father worked for the Southern Pacific Railroad as a coach painter. So he was an accomplished painter. But just recently I was reading an interview that Otis Oatfield had with a docent at the Smithsonian Institute a few years prior to his death. And he was talking about, the interviewer asked him, oh, your father must have influenced you in your painting career. And he says, no, not actually. He said, it was my mother. She was pregnant with me, and she looked at some painting, and she became inspired. And she started painting at that point in time. And Otis said he thought that his mother had much more talent than his father. So this first painting is, it looks like the pointillism style that was popular. It still is popular. And Otis is probably known, when you think about San Francisco, and if you've ever gone to the Coit Tower, he was one of the WPA projects painters who were hired by the WPA to paint murals in the inside of the Coit Tower. Also in this interview with the Smithsonian, he tells this story, which I think is interesting, that one of the painters, it wasn't he, but painted a hammer and sickle and sort of camouflaged it in one of the murals in the Coit Tower. And since they were being paid by the WPA and therefore the United States government withheld the salary of all the artists until this hammer and sickle was in fact removed from this one mural. So I thought that was an interesting story. He says that he got paid $40 a week to do the paintings that he did, as well as the other artists got paid, I'm sure, about the same. Over here is a painting. It's done in 1924, and it's the interior of a Basque shepherd's home. Now, Otis studied in Paris, and he lived in France for a while, and he became so good at French that he was also mistaken for a French national. And he was worried that he may not be able to come back to the United States because they would mistake him for a Frenchman. So he worked for the French intelligence as an interpreter. That's how good he was at the French language. So it's not surprising that he painted these pictures in the Basque country, and I'm assuming that it's a French Basque as opposed to Spanish Basque. Okay, here's in the second gallery, this is Hay Barge, Alaskan Coast. And this is another one of Otis Oatfield's pictures. It says that it's a watercolor. I'm more inclined to think it's a charcoal. And it's not nearly as colorful as his murals in the Coit Tower. If any of you have had an opportunity to see those wonderful murals in the Coit Tower, which have just recently been restored. So I was there during the restoration project, and I'm eager to go back to see the final. We're still talking about muralists, as Otis Oatfield was. There's another very famous muralist from San Francisco who did murals in the library in San Francisco, and that's Piazzoni, if I'm pronouncing his name right, Piazzoni, and which I think is ironic because he painted on a huge canvas, and Maylene Bacon-Boggs' collection shows this one painting of his at Waldo, it's called, and it's very, very tiny. We also wonder if sometimes the muralist painted these smaller paintings sort of as a prototype and then translated them into the larger canvas. His original mural that was in the San Francisco Library when the library was transferred over and remodeled into the Asian Museum, his work was going to be destroyed. But thanks to some wonderful preservationists, those murals were saved and are in, I believe, the De Young. Another ironic piece where we're talking about Piazzoni and how he was a muralist and painted on a large canvas. Well, there's a little bit of irony here as well. This little painting by Charles Dorman Robinson, it's called Mount Rainier. The date is unknown. It's done on a composition board, not on stretch canvas. But it's a lovely little painting. But the interesting thing about this particular artist is that he did over 100 paintings of the Yosemite Valley. And he was known as the Dean of the Pacific Coast Artists. And John Muir and he worked hand in hand. And these paintings of the Yosemite Valley were used to influence Roosevelt into dedicating that land as a national park. And in October 1st, 1890, Yosemite received the national park designation. And in the second gallery, there's a painting by Frederick Schaefer of the Yosemite Valley. Many of these painters who painted the Yosemite Valley, these paintings were shipped back to Washington, D.C. for the lawmakers in Washington to see firsthand as you can get with these beautiful colored paintings of the Yosemite Valley. There, of course, black and white photography was in then, but it doesn't capture the real beauty if you can't see these places in color and the wonderful majesty of it. This wall of all the clipper ships were done by a fellow by the name of Denny, and his name was Gideon Jacques Denny, and he was originally from the Chesapeake, Maryland area, and he had a love for ships, obviously, because he spent most of his career painting them. These pictures are particularly interesting because they're done on zinc, and these were in the ferry that would cross the bay to get to San Francisco. The Golden Gate Bridge was built and the ferry was no longer used and was decommissioned. These paintings were in the upstairs salon, I guess it would be the first class section of the ferry. And when the ferry was decommissioned, May Helene Bacon Boggs's husband was in the salvage business. And he was trying to salvage these, get what he could out of the decommissioned ferry. And May Helene said, ah, no, I want those paintings. So she saved all of Denny's paintings from the ferry boat, which was just a wonderful find. Then, as we're talking about collaborative painting between female artist and male artist, when we talked about Thaddeus Welch and Vlad Mitala. The other thing about Denny's paintings that I have read, that he collaborated with a woman by the name of Elizabeth Rockwell, and she also did paintings of ships. So the two of them worked somewhat collaboratively. When you when you travel around, for instance, I went to Honolulu and went to the museum in Honolulu, and there are many of Denny's paintings in Honolulu. In room number two, in gallery number two, there's a painting of Marston's Brooks Gallery done by Deakins. And I think it's interesting to note, because Deakins and Marston Brooks shared studios in San Francisco, but a lot of these artists taught each other, took classes from each other, shared studios. And Denny is no different. He actually first met Marston Brooks in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and took lessons from him then. And then they both moved to San Francisco, where they did, in fact, share a studio together. So it's always interesting to see the interweaving of all of these artists in their lives.
While we're talking about the Coit Tower in San Francisco, which, as you know, was built as a tribute to the firefighters of San Francisco, there was a famous sculpture by the name of Haig Patigan, and his painting or pastel of, is it a pastel? Let's see. Yes, it is a pastel of the owl that's in the Bohemian Grove. Now, when I gave the introduction, I told you the common thread that seems to run through all of these artists is that somehow or another, most of them were connected to the Bohemian Club. And the Bohemian Club would hold an annual retreat each summer in the Bohemian Grove. And the men, of course, it was all men, no women were permitted, and still to this day, women are not permitted in the Bohemian Club. They go and to this retreat in the summer. I think they spend as long as a week there. And the idea is that they have this huge bonfire where they write their cares on a piece of paper and they throw it into this fire, and that's supposed to be some sort of a healing process. And this is my personal opinion, but I wonder if this wasn't a precursor to our Burning Man that we have today. Yeah. This painting was done in 1884, and it's called Liberty and Love. And this is, of the people who come to see these paintings, this is usually one of their favorites. And I think in large part because it's so expressive. The man looking at her as if he's trying to talk her into something or apologize, and she's has her head turned as if she doesn't want to hear what he has to say. I just think it's a sweet, sweet picture of these two people. But what's also interesting, when you see in the background, and lots of times at first glance, people don't see that because they're concentrating on the foreground pictures, foreground people. We know that that France gave the Statue of Liberty to the United States, and it was supposed to be given to the United States as a 100th birthday present. It was supposed to arrive in 1776. But during that time, there was a major depression in Europe, and France ran out of money to complete the statue. And so I think this picture is interesting. It shows the Statue of Liberty in construction. During the 1876 exposition in Philadelphia, I believe the torch was sent over and displayed in anticipation of the rest of the Bertholdi statue. There was a fellow by the name of Pulitzer who rallied people in the United States to come up with the additional funding to complete the statue and have it sent to the United States. So although we look at it as a gift from France, and it was, and that's what started out, but I think the Americans brought it over the finish line.